IIT Jalandhar. She has a long and illustrious service career of serving at National Institute of Technology Jalandhar. She has published more than 30 research and technical papers in various journals and conferences. She has also published book for Red Sign Publisher, Sweden. She has organized many short-term courses, faculty development programs at National Institute of Technology Jalandhar. She is an active member of various international and national organizations and societies like Institution of Engineers India, IAENG, ASCE, and Indian Concrete Institute. So now I request to ma'am to start his session.
Yeah, thank you so much for the nice introduction. So I will start with So my today's topic is bridge construction practices using incremental launching. So you all know that what is a bridge? It is a structure built across an obstacle such as body of the water, valley or road for the purpose of providing passage over the obstacle. Now when we have to design the bridges, there are many factors on which it depends, like the length of the bridge, span of the bridges, and the nature of the terrain, the material to be used. So depending upon all these things, we can construct the bridge in different ways. So the first thing that we can do is we can just cast in situ method. We can adopt that method. So what we do in that method, so generally for short bridges, we do all the work of erection, of casting of concrete, everything at the site itself. So for that, what we need to do, first of all, we will do the erection on the ground supporting the staging. So the false work that has to be done, then the casting of concrete would be done, and then the dismantling of the staging is done. But this method is very time consuming. So generally, we prefer this method only for the short bridges. But sometimes there are complex conditions or there are some unusual geometrical shapes. Even in that case, we cannot go for other methods and we have to adopt the cast in situ method. But the method which is nowadays used for the construction of bridges or flyovers, that is the segmental bridge construction. A segmental bridge is a bridge built in short sections, which are called segments, that is one piece at a time. And then these segments, they are erected to make the bridge. So in this case also, this bridge, this can be either cast in place or it can be precast. So these are these, for example, small segmental, if it is a segmental box bridge. So these segmental box girders, generally they are precast and they are just transported to the site and they are joined together. So in this case, if you will see, this method is very economical for long spans. Here the prefabricated segments, they provide more quality control. The structure can be fully loaded immediately after being pre-stressed. So it can be put to the use very, very, very soon. And low weight due to these thin bridge sections, and the whole construction process is industrialized. So that's why from the 1950s this method has been adopted. Now, if you will see the application to this segmental bridge, there are a lot of bridges, different types of bridges that can be constructed with this method. Now, for example, the urban bridges, the long span bridges, environmentally sensitive areas, construction, long bridges over water, the arches, cable stayed bridges, rail bridges, all these they can be constructed by this method. So what we do in this method, first of all the support towers, they will be built segmentally. After that, we can use the slip form construction also to build the understructure. So here we have to make the use of the false work. For everything, for towers we need the false work, and but the superstructure here we can just launch the segments which have been precast. So if you will see at the site, if we are producing it, then we need to do the concreting just like we do in any building. What we do there, we just place the concrete, we let it cure, and then the false work that is removed. But if the precast bridge is there, then these segments they are constructed on the ground and then they are transported and hoisted into the place. The segmental construction, if you will see, these are the following steps which we usually go for. First is the casting of segments, so that is generally done at one place, which is a casting yard. There we cast the segments. Then these are transferred at the erection site with the help of a traveler or a crane. So when we have to lift these segments, so either they can be lifted with the help of the strap under the wing, or we have kept the holes, special holes. So the lifting of segment can be done through lifting. Holes. So while lifting, you will see the force, the nature of the force will also be different, and the magnitude of the force and the stresses induced in the elements that come completely different from what they will be subjected during construction. So when we have to go for this method, then we have to keep these stresses also in mind. And sometimes the stresses which are during the construction phase, those are even more than the stresses induced during the operating phase of these bridges. So this is one of the disadvantage of this. After that, these precast segments, they are erected at the site, and then we are having the four different methods for the erection of these segments. So these four methods are, first one is the balanced cantilever erection, then second is progressive placement erection, third is span by span erection, and fourth one is incremental launching in erection. So after erecting these, we have to glue them to prevent the leakage of grout, and then the external pre-stressing is done to give the final strength to the bridge. After pre-stressing, we have to grout all the holes in which the conduits and the wires are there, reinforcing wires are there, then we need to grout them. So now I will discuss the different methods one by one. The first method of erection is balanced cantilever method. So here in this method, you can see on one pier, we will start the construction and we will start from the center, but on both the sides. So here also we will proceed in this direction, and here also we will proceed in this direction. So in this way, the cantilever forces on this direction and this direction, they should be balanced. So that's why if we are putting one segment over here, then we will put the another over here, then here, then here, and sometimes simultaneously the traveler foam, one traveler foam, it moves in this direction and casts this side, and another traveler foam is used, which is doing the casting or erection in the other side. So this is the balanced cantilever method. So in this way, when we do the construction, we start from the center of the pier and move towards the end until at the middle we put the joining piece. So this method also, this can be done by cast in situ method. And if we are doing the cast in situ method, then first of all, we will do the construction of all the piers. So the complete pier segment is then used as an erection platform to support the foam traveler for cast in place segments. After that, the soffit shuttering, shuttering for web and deck shuttering, that is fixed on both the sides of piers. And similarly, the concreting is done on both the side of the piers simultaneously. So in this way, the production rate of these travelers, that is generally one segment every 5 days per traveler. And each cast in segment, if you will say, it is 3 meters to 5 meters in length, with formwork moving in tandem with each segment. So here you can see from both the sides, the work has been started simultaneously, and at each pier, the work has been started simultaneously on both the directions. And so here, if we are going for the precast bridge, then the segments, they are just taken over the site. And then after the erection platform has been made of the piers, then these sections, they are just assembled and installed with the help of the lifting frame. Then we need to construct and cure the wet joints. And then next pair of precast segments that comes until we place the closing unit in the center. So after, from both the sides, when the work is progressed, at the middle, we have to place the closing unit, and these both, they are joined together. Then second method is the progressive placement method. We are not starting from the middle of the pier, but the bridge construction that starts from the one end, and progressively one segment we place from here, then here, then here, we move in other direction. So in between, sometimes if the span is more, then we need to provide the temporary supports also. Some false work that is required also to support the bridge till it is ready to use, or till it has been pre-stressed and is able to take the external force. So a lot of false work is, or the scaffolding and the foam work that is required in this method. So then comes the span by span. It is also just like the progressive method, but here we will take the one span at a time. So between these two piers, this much of your foam work should be ready if it is in cast in situ, or when you are erecting it by transferring the precast segments, then also the segments which make the one span, they are installed at a time, and then the next span and next span till the bridge is complete. So here, now we come to the main method, that is the incremental bridge construction. So if you will see the incrementally launched bridge, the principle behind is that we have to incrementally progress the construction. So here in this method, the superstructure segments, they are cast in a casting yard, which is just behind the bridge abutment. So from there, now each segment which is cast, it should match the previous one. Then it is pre-stressed to the section of the superstructure already built. The entire superstructure is then jacked forward a distance equal to the length of the segment, and this process is repeated until the bridge is in its final position. Here we don't need to put any false work. Just when there are deep valleys underneath, when there are the areas where we cannot go, okay, when there is a deep river or in the sea where safety is also we have a concern. So in those conditions, we can go for the incremental launching technique. So here the casting yard is made, okay, so where the all the segments, they are cast, and then with the help of this launching nose and the hydraulic jacks which are over here, this cast section, it is moved in this direction. Similarly, in the meantime, the next section that is being constructed or cast in the casting yard, then this is further moved, and this process is repeated till the entire span and the length of the bridge is covered. So here you can see the different paths. So here the segments, these are the segments which are constructed. This is the direction of launching, okay? And this is the launching nose. This hole, it is supported over the bearings, okay? These are known as the sliding bearings. So these sliding bearings, they reduce the friction as well as they distribute the load over the piers. Now we will also consider the stresses, which are the stresses coming over there. Before that, I will just want to show you the actual picture where this is the launching yard, and here the casting is going on, and with the help of the hydraulic jack, it is sliding. At every pier, we are having the sliding bears which help this structure to move forward. And the length of this launching nose, that is generally 60% of the span between these two piers. So for example, if we want to move it in this direction, so at one point there will be position, it will be freely suspended from this pier. So here the cantilever forces would be there, and when it reaches up to this point, the length of the cantilever is maximum, the maximum stresses would be there, and this magnitude of stresses is such as once it is under operation, it will never go to that stress level. So that's why to reduce the stresses, we join a launching nose, so that after some length which we design, that the stresses, they are within the permissible limit, this launching nose, it is resting over the another pier, so that instead of acting as the cantilever, it is acting as a simply supported beam. So that's why this launching nose is there, so that it is supporting the whole superstructure. So if you will see the progress of the work over here, So generally, there are 15 meters to 30 meters long units of the bridge under factory conditions, which are behind an abutment. And then these are launched on the Teflon bearings into the final position. And here you will see we don't require any false work. We don't require any auxiliary fire. We don't require the scaffolding. And there is no danger to the workmen because they are not working in the danger zone. So these are all the advantages of this method. So we can have a look over here. These are the different steps. We can say that the lifting of oil cylinders is activated first of all, then it uplifts the entire structure from the pad beam. So steel bridges, they can be also erected with this technique, and the concrete bridges, they can be also erected with this technique. So up till now, more than 2000 bridges they have been constructed using this technique. So in India, the LNT is constructed most of the bridges with this technique nowadays. And here you can see the step number two, then the launching of oil cylinder that is activated to move the girder structure and the upper part of the launching system move forward. Then the lifting of oil cylinder is released and descended, and the steel arch girder structure is laid down on temporary pad beam. And after that, the launching oil cylinder is released again, and the whole launching system is back to initial state. A launching cycle is completed and is ready for the next repetition. I will show you a small video. Of the construction by this incremental launching technique. So here, first of all, the foam work that is constructed. Okay, so behind the apartment, we have to make our casting yard. So for that, the foam work, which is of the exact size and shape of the members, that is prepared first of all. So here they are preparing the casting yard first of all. So the casting yard, again, it should be able to take the load and the stresses which are there during the construction of the units. So the foam work that is being prepared over here, first of all. So the box girder bridge is there. So that's why the complete segment of that box girder, for that the foam work is being prepared. So at the bottom, you know, it is trapezoidal shape. So that's why they are preparing it in this way. So because we are not going to prepare just the one unit in this formwork, so number of segments which will complete the entire length of the bridge, they would be constructed. So number of cycles would be there. So that's why this foam work, it should be very strong. So it can be used again and again and again. And while the launching nose and the hydraulic jack arrangement that is pulling the segments, it should be able to take that load also. So after the foam work is complete, then we need to put the reinforcement. Then the inner side of the foam work that would be completed. The cap equal to the thickness of the segment that would be kept over here. and then the concreting would be done. So first of all, reinforcement is being placed, and after that the inner part of the formwork that is installed. So then concreting is done of the sides and the base, and then we have to prepare the formwork for the top slab. So now the formwork for the top slab. So here you can see the rate of construction by this method is 30 meters per week. So the bridge which are as long as 1 kilometer, they can be cast very fast with this method. And so it is joined with the mounting nose with the help of the hydraulic jacks.
Madam, your screen is not visible, madam.
Screen is not visible?
Yes, madam.
Okay, just a second.
Actually, screen is visible, sir. Please pin the screen that is being shared by Shailja ma'am.
Okay.
I will rejoin it. Now it's okay.
Screen is visible, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, screen is visible. Professor sir, please search in the group list. Dr. Shailja.
It's okay, sir. Now it's okay. Now it's visible.
Jee, sir.
Right. Thank you, sir. Now it's visible.
Okay. So till after that is pushed ahead, the next segment that is prepared in the same way by the time, and the prepared section that is pulled with the help of the hydraulic jack having 4 hydraulic pistons. And there are Teflon bearings. Generally, they are steel bearings which are coated with the Teflon. And like this, now you will see that arrangement for pushing the segment. So there are bearings on each pier. Okay, so in this method, so you can see no scaffolding or false work is required when the superstructure is constructed. And here you can keep a better control over the total overview and the control of the production. So that's why it leads to higher quality. We are having another benefits, for example, no transportation of the material and staff that is required, because all the construction that is located in the casting yard. But there is one disadvantage also. The disadvantage of this method is this deck has to be straight, or if curvature is there, that has to be of constant curvature. Second thing is special bearings are required at the supports. Third is jacking system is required to push the segments. And this launching, this is carried out by specialist contractors. So due to which we can have the increased price. So that's why these are not economical for the short bridges, but long bridges, when you will see the cost of these extra materials, the false work and everything, then you will find these more economical because it is fast also and safety is also there. And if we will talk of the equipment, here, first thing is the whole process, that is having the centralized computer control. Because you know, there are many factors that has to be considered. For example, while launching, there may be lateral displacement that we have to avoid because it may damage the part or it may cause some extra stresses in the pyres. So that's why that has to be kept in mind. So all we are having different sensors. There are pressure sensors to measure the working pressure of the cylinders. There are displacement sensors for launching oil cylinder travel distance measurement. And there are angle sensors also to record the hybrid girder longitudinal slope with accuracy up to plus minus 0.05. So here the synchronized lifting oil cylinder, launching oil cylinder and transverse adjusting of oil cylinder should be there. So that's why it should be recorded and monitored at every time so that there is a, you know, we have to monitor the limit of the horizontal forces of the support piers. Everything should be within the allowable limit and the process should go steadily. Here, so as you have seen now the process, so you know the first thing that we require is we need to construct the bridge superstructure, which is done with the help of the stationary formwork, and the length of each segment, which is cast at a time, that is 1/3 to 1/2 of the normal span length. Then everything that will obviously depend upon the climatic conditions also. So if such conditions are there, you need to cover the plant, and there should be one unit where the hardening of these segments that will be there, and then these are launched in another week. Launching nose. So now its length is very important, as I told you, because if our unit, it acts for much length as a cantilever, then the stresses, they would be quite large. So when our segment, it fits on the two piers, then the nature of stress is also reversed. You will see in the nature will change from hogging to sagging, or from sagging to hogging. So positive to negative moments change when it acts as a cantilever or when it acts as a simply supported. So that's why generally whatever superstructure beam is there, we have to keep in mind its span to depth ratio. So its slenderness ratio should be below 17, first thing is there. And generally, most of the cases, we limit it between 12 and 15. And length of all the spans, that should be equal. And the length of this nosing launching, that should be around 60% of the regular span length. And then Sometimes, if we have not kept in mind about the stresses and we see these the stresses, they are going to increase, then to reduce that stress, we need to provide the auxiliary pliers or some auxiliary arrangement. Now, for example, if the length of the nose is not appropriate, then what will happen? As I told you, that the bending moments, they at the time of launching, they will increase. To limit those movements, there are three things. We can increase the length of the launching nose. Second thing is we can provide the auxiliary pliers. Third thing is sometimes we need to thicken the web plate of these girders. We need to provide more cross-section. We need to provide more cross-section of the pliers. So in this way, but if we will go for this method, then the cost will increase. So generally for the incrementally launched bridge, the thickness is more, but in the long run, if you will see that it would compensate the other costs of the construction. Then comes the sliding bearings. So these sliding bearings, these are of concrete blocks covered with stainless steel and then Teflon coated reinforced elastomeric pads. They serve two purposes. First one is they reduce the friction while launching, and second thing is they distribute the load over the head of the pliers. Then comes the launching equipment. It is combination of hydraulic jacks. So sometimes your bridge in the hilly area, they are on the slope. Okay. So when it is on the slope, then the extra load will come over the bearings. Next comes the equipment control of launching process. Now, as I told you, there is centralized computer control for everything. We have to monitor everything. But sometimes, before starting the actual process, actually the whole process that is simulated in the lab. And when we do the designing, we make the FEM model and we design everything. But sometimes there are some uncontrollable things. Sometimes there may be the failure of the equipment. It may, if it is on the slope, it may come back. Then we need the arrangement for that also. So at every stage, your process that should be monitored, and the stresses, they should be calculated with the help of the displacement sensors and the load sensors, and it should be matched with your simulated one, because you have designed everything for your according to your simulation. So if anything goes beyond that, then how to control that, that should always be kept in mind before starting the actual process. So this was about the construction. Then comes the design considerations during launching of bridge by incremental launching method. Now, first of all, we should know what are the different forces which are going to be there, which forces we should keep in mind while designing everything. So the first thing that is the substructure effects caused by the launching forces. So because while this launching process is going on, there are extra forces on the substructure. What are these forces? These forces are, first thing is the vertical load. Okay, due to the dead load, support reaction at the pier. Second is the horizontal loads, which are generated by the friction and other resistant forces in the bearings as well as the local grade of the launch surface. And third thing is the transverse horizontal component generated by the lateral guide of the system. So, because when we are going to launch them, vertical load is surely come to due to the movement and the friction, horizontal loads are there, and there are transverse loads also. If we are not guiding it laterally properly, then extra transverse force they would be generated. After that, second is the lateral guidance and steering control during launching. So when we have to launch it, then we need to provide the lateral guidance system, because there may be some curvature and your concrete deck that is not following that path, due to which there would be extra lateral movement, and which should not be exceeded to give you the more stresses than the design. So at every level you have to check the lateral displacement, and you have to guide your segment laterally so that it is on the track at every movement. Then the third method is wind forces during launching. Sometimes when it is the open area in the sea, or it is in the valley where the wind speed is, you know, more than 30 miles per hour, then we have to consider these wind forces also, because it may change the lateral direction of the movement. So when we have to design, we have to take the effect of both the static as well as the dynamic wind forces. So proper analysis should be done. And when the cantilever up to the point, your superstructure is at maximum cantilever, then these forces would be maximum. So we have to keep for longer spans, the wind fairings should be used to improve the aerodynamic performance of the cantilever span. So then this effect that can be minimized. Third is reversible launching system. So again, in order to reduce the chance that the bridge is left in a position for extended time, so that your launching system may fail, or due to excessive load, or when it is on the upper slope on the upstream side, then what can happen? Sometimes it can move back. So to stop that movement, which is in the opposite direction, we need to keep in mind that we will require reversing. Then is the lateral bracing system for steel girder spans. So if it is a steel bridge, okay, then we have to consider that there should be considerable resistance against torsional buckling during the launch. We are using eye girder bridge or any other bridge, we need to provide the lateral bracing also for that. Then temporary supports and auxiliary piers. So again, they may be required at the mid span. Sometimes if the span is very long, then we need to provide these temporary piers to reduce the cantilever length. Otherwise, if you will increase the cross section of the towers or your box girder, then the cost may increase. But you know, because the stresses, they are maximum during the erection time. So we don't need to go for that. We can just provide the auxiliary buyers or temporary supports. Required jacking forces to overcome friction and longitudinal crane. Great. So again, low friction roller system is recommended. And sometimes when they have to move on the move over the grade, then also we want that in any circumstance, if there is mechanical failure during the launch event, it should not roll back. So there should be proper jacking force which should be there to prevent the rolling back on the upgrades. So the bearings, if we will see, they should be planned so that under the static condition, they are not giving us more than 1 to 2% friction coefficient. And on the grade, the jacking system that should be able to control the mechanics of the launching system. Then comes analysis of erection stages. At erection stage, the envelope of flexure moment and shear force that should be calculated. And generally, when we do the computer program, we do it for infinite number of support conditions. So an envelope that is made and the calculations are then accumulated in the case of the bridge constructed with the post-tension concrete, because in that case there are additional effects due to the creep and shrinkage and also due to the thermal gradients. So all those should be considered. And last one is the design of specialized bridge components. Us, we have that experience also, so that can also be utilized while designing the system for the new bridges. Friction, and we should distribute the load and should be capable of taking that load. Then design of launching nose. Launching nose, I already told you that its length and the again, it should be able to take the force. So this launching nose, it is also generally constructed at the site only. So for the first span, they can just start with the construction of the launching nose. Are there in the bridge when the steel girder moves and it is so in this way, so whenever we have to design the launching nose, it also plays a very important part to keep the stresses under the limit. So there are few points which we have taken from the literature available on the incremental process. So whenever there are precast concrete bridges which are launched incrementally, then your deck is needed to resist the same transitory stresses and everything, the cross-sectional moment of inertia, web thickness, size, these are affected by the temporary construction stresses and results in increased cost of material. But if you will compare the cost at the end, then you will see that it is more economical. So generally these bridges, their decks have greater depth and uniform thickness over the length of the bridges relative to the conventionally constructed bridges. And then according to Grenat, in 2003, he has said that when they were studying, then the finite element models that were prepared for the simulation, they were of three times normal, slender and stocky. And when they considered, they found that when no bending moment is applied at the girder ends, the girder could be damaged by the traveling patch load at a level of 59 to 60% of the load carrying capacity. So that's why these should not be increased from 42 to 49%, because at this level no damage was there. So while designing, we should keep the ultimate load less than the 42 to 49% of the ultimate load carrying capacity of the units. Similarly, the transfer matrix limits the risk of mistakes, and it should be implemented in a computer program. And that's why we should always consider all the stresses or the redundant conditions which may arise there. So as the launching progresses, so we have to keep and we have to update the system. We discussed here that the stresses, they keep on increasing due to the cantilever length. So one of the solution was that the superstructure, they can be made of better thickness and better cross section so that it is able to take that load. But again, that is very costly. So to make it more cost effective, this one method that has been suggested. So if you will see the stresses, then you can see the magnitude in over here. If you will see up to here, this length, up to this length, and just a second. So just to limit the stresses, what they did, they prepared a double upper deck in the new system. So this upper double deck, it can slide in the this direction forward, and it is attached with the launching nose and it supports your segment. Are there. So what were the disadvantages of the launching method? That the bridge may be subjected to the different structural schemes during the construction stage, or the bridge is completely erected, and when it is the serviceability stage begins, then it acts as a continuous beam. So there is a complete reversal of the stress in both the conditions. And secondly, the variation of boundary condition during the launching process. Okay, it was also giving the alternate signs of bending movements along the whole deck, and their absolute values were also higher than the service ones. So that's why we needed to reduce those stresses. So for that, this new bridge launching method, it was designed so that we can place one more, you know, extra bridge deck or upper deck over the system. So it will be called double deck, and it will collaborate with your segments wherever there are weakest section in terms of the bending or shear resistance. And when the structure is moved, it gets maximum cantilever span. There we can place it to counteract the stresses. So if we are following this method, then obviously we do not require to increase the cross section, and our bending moment, shear and torsional effects, everything would be within the limits. And we don't need to modify the design due to our. So because it was the earlier method, we required to provide the auxiliary means. But when we are giving the new method, then we don't require these auxiliary means, because the stresses, they will be taken by this double deck. So for the double deck, you can see here you can see the main structural elements. So the piers are there. This is the launching nose. This is the main deck. Okay. And this is the upper deck. Okay. So it moves forward to support the cantilever length, and it is attached with the help of the backward gussets and the forward gussets to the main deck. So I will consider few bridges which have been constructed by. This method. So the first one is that a Romeo viaduct. So it is eight span, continuously curved box girded bridge in Cyprus. So there is a deep valley, you know.
Madam, your voice is breaking. We are unable to hear you,
Dr. Shalja, ma'am.
Yes, hello. Is it now audible?
Yes, yes, audible.
Okay. So the buyer's height of the here from 16 meters. Help the dampers, and these dampers, they compensate for the horizontal loads which were there. Comes the again.
Ma'am, voice is breaking. Can't hear properly.
Okay. To finish it. So here to counteract deflections, the push-pull jacks, they were used. And additions here, you can see the work which was originally planned for the one day that has to be delayed for 4 weeks. So difference between what was the planned and good and so condition in the city, they wanted to make and the amount of rail line closures
there is a network issue. Dear participants, please bear with us. Actually, our expert has left from this meet. She will rejoin again. We are just doing contact with the expert, please.
Okay, so bogie bill, you can see it is being launched. Okay, so photograph was taken from the casting yard, and there the different brick are on to be incrementally launched. So finally, it is being incrementally launched. So you can, this is the launching nose, and this is the superstructure which is being pulled with the help of the hydraulic jacks on the bearings. So now I come to the conclusion. There are a lot of advantages of this incremental launching method, because it is going to give you the minimal disturbance to the surroundings, and very small and concentrated area is required for the superstructure assembly. It is fast, it is safe also for the workers. So in many challenging conditions or sites, it can be used easily, just like on the deep valleys, deep water crossings, steep slopes, poor soil conditions, or environmentally protected areas. So in these cases also, it is very much useful. But the only drawback is that you have to use them either for the straight bridges or the superstructure of constant radius, so there it can be used efficiently. So thank you,
madam. Screen is not visible.
Okay, so that's all from my side, I think. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am, thank you very much, ma'am. And if any participant has any query or question related to the material that Dr. Shalja ma'am has presented in today's session, so participants can unmute your mic and directly you can ask the questions one by one. Okay, I guess ma'am, your presentation and your explanation was up to the mark, and they have no doubt till now.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much for inviting me. And thank you for the audience, which didn't disturb at all. So thank you so much.
Jiji. So ma'am, you are very much, we are very much thankful for your kind presence and valuable lecture during this online FTP on advanced construction technology being organized by the Department of Civil Engineering, NEL Singh Campus College of Engineering and Technology, Bathinda. We are very much thankful for your kind presence, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
And thanks to all the participants for patience hearing. Due to some network problem at our side also, we will send the attendance link in WhatsApp group. Not possible to send the link here right now. So I am just sending the attendance link in the WhatsApp group so that you can mark your attendance for session 2. Thank you very much. And this is for your information that we will start the valedictory ceremony. Because session 1 and 2, with that, we have concluded all the topics for this online FDP. Now the valedictory ceremony will be conducted at 2:30 p.m. sharp. The session will start at 2:30 p.m. So all the participants are requested to join the session up to 2:20 p.m. so that we can timely start the valedictory ceremony. And after the completion of valedictory ceremony, we will share the Google Form link for online quiz. Multiple choice questions will be there. तो हम लोग जो है आप लोगों को वो quiz जो है वो email के ऊपर भी और WhatsApp group में भी वो link हम लोग share करेंगे. So उसमें हम एक time limit भी देंगे, जिस जितने time में आप लोगों ने वो उसको solve करना होगा. तो आज ही वो quiz करना given time में ज़रूरी है, because we have to upload those marks and attendance record by today only in the coordinator login of Atal portal. So valedictory ceremony जो है उसके बाद आपको quiz की link दी जाएगी, और quiz को Google form की link है, उसी में अपने सही जो option होगा, चार option में भी सारे के सारे tick करते जाना है. So आप लोगों को पता है 60% जो मार्क्स आपको लेने जरूरी हैं सो दैट अटल एकेडमी कैन इश्यू द सर्टिफिकेट ऑफ पार्टिसिपेशन. तो थैंक यू वेरी मच, सी यू इन द वैलेडिक्टरी सेरेमनी. तो आप सभी को रिक्वेस्ट है कि वैलेडिक्टरी सेरेमनी में ज्वाइन जरूर कीजिएगा. सो जो पार्टिसिपेंट्स अभी अटेंडेंस लिंक पूछ रहे हैं, प्रोफेसर सत्येंद्र नारायण जी व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप में भेज रहे हैं हम आपको लिंक अटेंडेंस की, तो आप वहाँ पे अटेंडेंस लगा सकते हो. बस अभी मैं सेंड कर रहा हूँ दो टाइम. तो थैंक यू वेरी मच.
सर एट व्हाट टाइम दैट यू आर
जी मैम
एक्सक्यूज मी सर एट व्हाट टाइम दैट योर क्विज लिंक इज टू बी प्लेसिंग इन द व्हाट्सएप पर विद और थ्रू मेल सर व्हाट टाइम वी हैव टू आंसर द क्विज प्लीज प्लीज आई सर इफ यू से दैट
यस मैम यू आर ऑडिबल.
Yes, sir. We want the time. What time that we have to attend the quiz, and I write that exam.
We will at least give more than double time than the number of questions, so that you can easily answer the questions.
That's right, sir. But at what time that you are giving that paper? That at what time we have to attend that either mail or WhatsApp? That you have to say by the time that we have to get free. No, that's what.
Okay. Are you asking about the when to start the quiz, ma'am?
Yes.
Okay. Ma'am, actually, valedictory ceremony will start at 2:20 p.m. And maybe this will take 30 to 45 minutes for valedictory ceremony to complete. And And whenever this ceremony will complete, we will post the link for you.
So after the valedictory ceremony, that the quiz will be takes place.
Right, ma'am. Right.
Okay, before that. Okay.
Right. Then, so that all the participants can attend the valedictory ceremony without any other stress.
Yes. That's true. Okay. I thought of that before that 2:20. Maybe it was. That's what I have to attend. No? It's okay. Thank you, sir.
Ajay, you're right. No problem. Ajay, thank you very
much. Sir. Sir, next session attendance link, sir.
जी मैम, ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स कैन लीव दिस सेशन नाउ.
सर, दिस सेशन अटेंडेंस लिंक सर.
अटेंडेंस लिंक आई एम सेंडिंग इन व्हाट्सएप इन 2 मिनट्स मैम. व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप.
ओके सर, थैंक यू सर. ओके सर, थैंक यू सर. थैंक्स.